Okay, you want me to be your dad? Here I am.
No, I want you here. It's about the time.
Well, it's going pretty darn well.
How are you?
Paul, what's up with
well
you?
In your...
I think so.
Not much.
Well, not much is good.
Like, oh, yeah.
Actually, there's a lot of stuff going on. But
okay.
I don't want to bore you.
But it's definitely better.
Well, make stuff up.
Yeah,
make
there you go.
Exciting stuff.
I filled her up with Paul.
Pardon me?
I filled her up with...
Oh, good. Thank you for thinking of me as well.
Did you hear about that couple that left their honeymoon reception or wedding reception in helicopter
crash? Let me think. That's going to be
I have a loud projecting voice for my theater background.
The grandfather of the group is 78 years old.
Yes, it's I'll like, just turn it
he's
on.
He's still flying helicopter with age 78.
I think
that may have been mechanical. No, no,
there would be any like stuff.
Yeah, I heard about that. That was awful. Was that in Wisconsin?
And then
no, that's Texas.
Overland Crabby was like that.
I'll just add
Girl
this.
Those are the two.
Yeah, that too. Oh.
Absolutely.
He's going to line them all up and take one picture.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You okay?
Happy birthday.
Yeah, they're going to take a quick nap.
I could, be honest with you.
No, are you kidding? 28. You got two young?
I've started running again.
So
oh, that's yeah? Got me tired. I'm getting up at 4:20 in the morning to do it.
Holy Moses.
Yes.
Because that's only time
I'm treading 30. That's it.
You're running?
I'm treading 30.
We're at 20?
For the second
well,
time.
Actually, this is the week to start because of the hour time difference. Okay. It feels like 5:20.
But, yeah, it's... I'm tired.
Thank you. Call the meeting order at this time. Yeah, I don't have a gavel anymore.
You shouldn't have broke it.
I know. Anyway, I'll start with an introduction to board members. Kelly Coucher is out today. Ann Bauer, Bob Hesselbein, Kirk Kravetsky, Paul Kenny, and Clark Bob Jr., Superintendent George Magrolis, Annette Ashley, Sean Hyland, Todd Smith, Assistant Superintendent Sherry Sadra, and Director of Business Services, Lori Ames. At this particular time, we're going to start off with WSB Honor Roll and this recognition.
Thanks, Bob. So, we've done this every year since 2012, just a little bit of background first. So, the district has had 35 organizations recognized since the awards were established in 2012. That's the most of any school district of the 430 plus in the state of Wisconsin. This year, 19 school districts nominated more than 60 businesses for the Wisconsin Association of School Boards Business Honorable Awards. We have four of our five recipients here tonight, so I'll take a couple minutes to recognize them, give them a chance to speak as well. So the one business that couldn't be here tonight is All Channel Electronics. For those of you who are new, I always like to tell you a little bit about each business. So they have partnered with the district for more than 20 years. They handle many of our safety and security functions. Rick Minder is the president, and he sends his apologies, but wasn't able to make it. So the first person I'd like to introduce, first business, is Fleet Feet Sports on Old Sauk Road. And they have been instrumental in helping with the Run, Walk, Move event at Northside Elementary, donating tents, race bibs, staff, and most importantly, time. We're also very fortunate Jessica Anderson was able to make it tonight because her flight arrived on time. So Jessica, if you want to come up and say a few words, you're welcome to, and then we'll have you shake everybody's hand, and I'll give you a frame certificate and a pen and pencil set. And then at that point, once everybody's done, we'll get a picture with the group of Mr. Green, Mr. Memorandum. So,
yeah.
The floor is yours.
Thank you again. Yes, I barely made it in, I did. But yes, thank you. And I have to thank Mr. Craney. He's no longer the principal at Northside Elementary, but he is the one who nominated us. And thanks to the school board for choosing us as a finalist. When I was asked 5 years ago if I wanted to be involved in our children's school fitness fundraiser at Northside, I was thrilled. My husband and I had two children at Northside at the time. And we have a lot of experiences putting on fun runs and other local events, and knew that we could be a resource for our PTO. Our mission at Fleet Feet is empower the runner in everyone, and this event encourages the kids and the teachers and just gives them this excitement, and hopefully they'll have physical activity as a part of their life forever. Fleet Feet has been honored to help out and donate equipment, like they mentioned. We do it the second Friday in October. Our principal lets us have the first half of the day, and the students and the teachers run, walk, or move for 20 minutes. We set up a course the night before. It's all planned out with tents, if you have not been to one. And community members come out, as well as parents. They come out to volunteer. The camaraderie and the excitement, it is so much fun. We play music, and that morning, it's just the excitement is contagious. We just celebrated 4 years. This is the fourth year we've done it. And I know that the new principal is hoping it'll be a tradition at Northside. So thanks for having me.
Thanks, Jessica.
Yeah.
Jessica.
Oh, no.
Thank you.
Too bad. I forgot that part.
I'm
getting too excited.
Thank you, Jessica. I really appreciate
thanks.
It very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jessica.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Sorry that I almost forgot that part.
Well, looking apart, too. Yeah. Yeah. Got the tennis shoes on.
All right, our second business here tonight is Integral Building Systems. They partnered with the district to implement low-voltage cabling plants at several of our schools. They also took an active role in providing digital signage at West Middleton Elementary. I asked Bill Everhart to give me some extra information. He praised IBS for being highly professional and providing exceptional value. They are represented here tonight by IBS President, and I'll mispronounce it, you know you told me if I miss it, nope. Nissa Johnson, Vice President, Vice President Kevin Judd, and Strategic Alliance Manager, and also a member of my wedding party, and a fellow Portage graduate, Mark Considine. So come on up, you
Mark
three.
Considine.
And Mark will be mad at me for saying all that, so.
And you got it right, so good job.
Pure luck, that's all.
Can I miss it? We are very honored and blessed we would actually be able to be a part of this tonight. I know we're kind of excited as we're in the middle of celebrating our 10th year in business. Kevin and Nissa Judd started 10 years ago. We've been fortunate to be able to help out the district through like some things that Kevin said, but Nissa works and hard on the mom board, as a lot of you may know, and it's just been an honor to be a part of it. We're thankful.
Yeah, we have two kids that attend West Middleton. Both Kevin and I are graduates of Milton. I went to Northside myself, so.
Oh my.
West Middleton.
And West Middleton. Substitute teacher's like, are you Kevin Judd? And he's like, yes, it's me.
Mrs. Diamond is still at West Middleton, so.
Oh yeah, yeah, she still subs.
My first grade teacher, yep. I think. And she recognized me 38 years later or something.
Wow. That's impressive. That the patient.
Really excited to be able to help the district and see Cromery and the massive reconstruction that happened there. That was so cool. Mm-hmm. And do whatever we can to help. So thank you.
Thank you. Our third company is Single Wire Software. They provide public address and automated communication and building access response capabilities to our communication systems. Their efforts have made us a much more agile and responsive during crisis situations. I was also pleased that the partnership with us was featured in a story on WIC Channel 3 last year. So I had down that there are going to be two people here tonight, so I'm going to invite all three, CEO Paul Shane, Brad Parkle, who's worked closely with Jim Blodgett's team, and then who did I introduce?
Sorry.
I'll let you guys go ahead and speak.
Great. Well, thank you very much. We're honored to accept this award tonight. We have over 7,000 customers that use our software for emergency and mass notification around the world, but I would say nobody uses it better than the Middleton-Cross Plains School District. You guys have embraced the software, leveraged it to its fullest, and we're really, really proud to have you right in our backyard. And we thank James Blodgett, who has been very helpful in giving us good feedback as ways we can improve the product. And our goal is to keep kids safe, and we're really happy that you use our software. So thank you very much.
We're really happy.
Wow. Thank you.
Congrats on the award.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Really do appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
What he said.
Thanks so much for working with us.
Thank you.
Dear Perry did a nice job.
Then our final business will be honoring United GW Credit Union. So again, I know we've gone through this before, but just as a reminder, they established their first branch of public K-12 school at Middleton High School in early 2018. They hired MHS students to work at the branch and at other nearby locations. They bring staff in to help with financial literacy curriculum at the high school. They make scholarships available to graduating seniors, and they help with the cost of not only constructing the branch office, but relocating the athletics concession stand that had been in that location. I should have brought with me our October edition of Wisconsin School News, because that partnership was featured prominently by WASB. So
they all should have received that copy. So yeah. Yep.
They are represented here tonight by Director of Community Partnerships, James Johnson, and MHS Branch Manager, Mark Klingel. Come on up, guys. Oh, Mark, you got words prepared.
It's not the whole page. At the core of who we are as an organization is our belief that finances impact people's lives in a profound way, and we work to empower people to make good decisions about their money. When working for an organization, it's easy for me to get lulled into thinking we're living our values when I'm only listening to the voices of my fellow UW Credit Union employees. This award represents that outside of our four walls, it's recognized that we are succeeding in living out our beliefs, and we are having a positive impact on people. I'm the manager of the interns, as Perry said. I know that as educators, you have the same desires that I do, that we teach the next generation the virtues of putting one's best effort forth and doing an honest day's work, humility and wisdom in learning from our experiences, and courageously addressing ways to improve our workplaces and the lives of those we are fortunate enough to work with. So thank you, and we look forward to continuing to work with you all.
Thanks, guys.
I'll just say that when I heard we were getting an award, I said, wait a minute, we should be giving them an award. We have learned so much from this relationship, the ability to work with such committed staff, faculty, administration, and most especially students. I think each of us have dropped 10 years of age and have an experience to work with not just the students that we have brought on as interns, but students in classrooms and on projects. We're recent sponsors of the business program at the high school as well, and just really appreciate the openness and partnership that we have with the whole district. So thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. James, thank you so much. Great to see you again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
ATM
and office call. Thank you,
sir. Thanks. Thank you.
Do you want to get the photo now?
Yep.
Okay. Photo. Forgot.
Nothing special for you?
Is this it? Up to you. Yeah, let's bring those up, guys. Yeah,
we'll drink to the prince.
We'll put it right in the middle. It's not ideal.
We buy a birthday drink when it's over. Nobody's here celebrating that dreading. Yeah.
Trying to keep up with home and work, and it's challenging.
We'll buy a birthday drink if you have time.
Yeah, I think I do.
This will be a
so tall.
Kind of a short
Exactly.
I mean, like, coffee treatment.
Oh, what's up?
Oh, sorry, Paul.
Thank you. This is just for the website.
I did go ahead.
Nobody's activity.
You're in seventh grade.
Yeah,
it's not relaxed.
She had somebody. They're going to run against her. You want to have a debate in January and all that. But.
I kind of forgot to take out papers.
That makes it easier to win.
Yeah, it does. It does.
We're all good.
Obviously, I've got a whole lot of.
You? Oh, ready to send you a photo?
Oh, Paul?
Yeah. Oh, yes, that meeting. Yeah. I never did respond.
Before everybody takes off, before you guys take off.
spring, on the 16th.
Public private partnership.
I'm going to send out some language.
And everything that you guys, every person that's come up here and said how much they've gotten out of it, well, we really appreciate that too, because we know that we go and teach so much in our school, but the real world, that transition between what we do and where you guys are at, that's where the students really learn. So we really appreciate your attitude as well as your efforts for helping our students out. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
What, you're not staff? What?
I have another recognition. And this is from the Wisconsin School Boards Association, and we have four of our board members are receiving their recognition tonight for demonstrating a high level of commitment to Wisconsin public schools and by participating in WASB professional development opportunities. Earlier, Kurt Karbuski earned a level one award, and he received his award at a WASB presentation. So congratulations to Kurt.
Thank you.
We also have Todd Smith at a level one. Congratulations, Todd.
Thank you.
We have Annette Ashley at a level three. Congratulations, Annette. We have Bob Green at a level four. Congratulations, Bob. We're very fortunate.
Did I get a raise? Did I get a raise with your
heart?
Yeah. Thank you, George.
Raise your blood pressure.
And again,
right.
This award is just
there's only one way to accomplish that. Sorry.
It's just a recognition of the efforts that our school district and our board itself have taken to participate in WSB. So thank you for taking that extra time. And this is just a recognition of that time. Approval of minutes. Looking for approval regular minutes on October 22nd, 2018.
So moved.
Second.
Any questions, concerns? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Communications. Citizen comments. Anybody in the audience like to address the board at this time? No. Correspondence, board communications. And before we get into that, we discussed this briefly at the agenda committee. WSB has a school perception survey that we will participate in. George is going to, each person has
unique login.
Unique login. So he's going to scan those.
Oh my.
And then he's going to send them to you. So in case you don't happen to find yours or whatever, it'd be nice if all nine could participate. And then they'll share the results with us. And then also compare our answers with other school districts as well.
Kind of a board functioning tool. It'll give you some good feedback.
So that being said, communications.
Yes.
Last Monday and Tuesday, I attended the Upham Woods retreat with the Glacier Creek sixth graders, and that was incredibly fun. The kids were great, highly engaged, enthusiastic, a tremendous amount of energy that unfortunately carried into the evening, and especially after the lights were out, but did manage to get some rest, and it was a blast.
I attended the marching band banquet, marching band and color guard banquet on Saturday. So that was a big first time event, and they had about 300 kids participating in that event. So, good activity and good celebration.
I attended the Elm Lawn Orchestra open house, which was a wonderful event. There was some audience participation, so each kid got to pick a parent or a brother or sister to come up and play a song on the stringed instruments, and yes, I did it, and I didn't even screw up, so I'm happy with that. So it was fun and a well-done event.
Cool. And before you go, Paul, could you let us know about an award you just
won? Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's personal, not board business, but I was recognized as being one of the best lawyers in Madison for employment law.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
As George mentioned before, Bob and I were able to attend the WASB Region 12 meeting on the 23rd, and I went to it last year and enjoyed it this year again also, and it's just a great opportunity to network and compare notes with other board members from different districts, including, you know, our region, Dane County. So got to talk to some people from Monona Grove and Sun Prairie, and just kind of comparing notes, you know, some of the things that we are, challenges that we're experiencing together, and then things that are different as well. But and then also getting the report, kind of the statewide report and the legislative report, and of course the I heard from somebody there's some sort of election tomorrow, that was talked about a lot as far as the surveys of residents and things that are important to them. And again, education is right up there with, you know, is probably the major concern of people around the state, so that'll play well into the election tomorrow.
I attended the Glacier Creek PTO meeting where they had the informational meeting regarding the upcoming referendum. It was relatively well attended for such a starting out PTO. And then I also wanted to mention that I'm attending the WASB legislative dinner in Portage, and I think it's 14th or the 15th, but if anyone else is interested in going, it's in the evening, so throwing it out there. It is my birthday today.
I always say no, and then I remember something that I attended. But I thought it was worth mentioning because I attended the girls' volleyball banquet last night. And one parent mentioned to me, whose parent is a junior, that even though her daughter didn't make, you know, varsity or JV, she was really happy that the team made a second JV team. Otherwise, she would have been cut and wouldn't have had the opportunity to play volleyball. So the parents were very appreciative of the fact that their kids had another opportunity to play sports, and that's directly because of the change that the volleyball program made. I think at the instance of Bob Jors and you know, reflecting the will of this board, that the coaches try to make those opportunities. I also was really pleased to hear the coach, Franco, mentioned specifically to the entire assembly group and thanked Bob George, Bob was there, for doing that, for going out and finding the games for that JV2 team. I learned that the JV2 team only played one conference game. All of the other games that they played were from schools from around the area, not in our conference. So the point I'm trying to make is that that's what we asked Bob to do, and that's what we asked the athletic department to do, is do the work to help find opportunities for more kids to play sports. And that is happening. And the coaches were appreciative last night, and the parents were appreciative last night. So I thought that was a really nice kind of seeing our efforts and seeing the things that we've been talking about actually followed through and make it down right to the banquet. So I thought it was actually a really nice thing last night.
And then I'll just quick follow-up. A couple of things. First of all, I want to thank Perry and I want to thank George. How many?
53. But I didn't make all 53. He did 53. I probably did 47 or 46.
That's a lot of presentations, and that's a lot of time away from your family. So I know we're at an end to that portion of it, but I want to pass on my thanks, and as well as the board thanks, for all the time that you spent away from your family to help in the school district. So, give a round of applause for the judges.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Legislative.
Legislative.
We're going to be meeting on the 16th prior to the school visits at the Crossroads Coffee House in Cross Plains. And we are going to be talking about language on a couple of items, one being special ed funding and the other being teacher credentialing. So we hope to have some language coming forward for the next meeting.
The time, it was 7 a.m., I believe?
7:30.
Thank you. I just wanted to make sure people knew the time. Great.
I have 7:45 on my...
Oh, you do?
Is it 7:45?
7:30 is fine.
What time is the board visit scheduled for?
Yeah, that's what I was wondering.
Well,
you can come.
Yeah, I mean, Park starts at 7:45. Glacier starts at 8:20. So, just so that Cheryl knows the time, then she can post it.
Let's do 7:30.
Okay.
7:30? Okay, 7:30. Thank you.
7:30. Yes.
Going once.
Going twice.
Okay. Good?
Yep, thank you.
Okay. You want me to... Keep going.
Sure.
Kurt actually stole my thunder. The election's tomorrow.
Sorry.
Did you know that?
It's on our mind.
So anyway, that was my big news. I thought I'd surprise people. Board visits are next Friday, not this Friday, as Ann just mentioned, Park and Glacier Creek. How many of you are planning on attending? So we kind of like to let, so Cheryl, you got the, you wanna, wow, great turnout. So you got them all? All right, thank you. Excellent. And then finally, that same evening on the 16th at 8 p.m., Bob Jors is looking for some board members to attend, I believe it's a basketball game, for some honors recognitions at halftime. I believe, Todd, you said you could attend?
I put on my calendar, yeah.
Okay, anybody else? Can any other board members attend that night?
Not this time, but
okay, so it'll be you and Bob.
It's on my
Bob
calendar.
Bob Jors,
no,
perfect, thank you. That's it.
Well, again, Annette.
Yes.
Yes Committee is going to have a gathering tomorrow, is that correct?
Yes, at the Sport Bowl, 8 Sport, o'clock.
Sport Bowl, 8 o'clock. For lecture results, so everybody's interested. And while I did mention George and Perry, we should also mention the Yes Committee, how many hours of work. I know as just the organizational part, we reached out and, you know, set up with Paul and that's your husband, as well as Kelly, you know, on University Avenue, but that was just a very small part of everything that everybody's doing. So a lot of behind the scenes going on that we don't directly see at the board level, but it's obviously been, will make an impact. So again, my thanks to everybody involved in the effort through the SBA as well. Referendum update.
No, that was it. The election's tomorrow.
Election's tomorrow.
That's my referendum update.
Okay. Consent agenda. At this point in time, I offer up for your approval 6A, administrative business services, approval of bills payable, employee services, certified staff, approval of resignation, approval of leave of absence, and approval of staff appointments.
I'll move that we approve.
Second.
Any questions, concerns? All those in favor say aye.
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 Okay. Items for information discussion. Equity quarterly report was moved two board meetings out.
Yep.
So that will not be on tonight. So Tabitha, surprise. Thought you had a few extra minutes.
No, it's fine. Great. I saw that was moved, so I kind of figured I'd be a little early here. So I'm just going to open up a quick little summary document. So I know you all received the report. It included some fund graphs and things. They're all graphs you've seen before. They are the same that we looked at last year. As we approached the data this year, we just updated it, gave you yet again another view of that. Nothing has significantly changed with our teacher turnover data overall, I will tell you. We are still hovering just under 10%. As evidenced by the information. You do see a few fluctuations in terms of the reasons why people have left. But overall, I would say that's really good news because it hasn't moved significantly. I am anticipating potentially a little bit higher retirement numbers this year. But that changes year by year, and we never really know until we get to February, but the rumblings and the questions and the follow-up that I've received from a number of staff would indicate that I think those numbers might be a bit higher this year. We'll see if that turns out to be true. Where I'd really like to take our conversation, however, tonight and share some updated information is because of looking at this data for 4 years with our teachers, we decided it might be important for us to take a look at this data for our support staff as well. We do see significant turnover in our support staff area, and we wanted to understand better about those numbers. And so we went about reviewing that, and Diane Austin is an amazing staff member in our business and employee services team. She's the one who works with all of our support staff groups. And as she has reviewed that information, she found that we have had, in the 17-18 school year, we had 60 turnovers in our support staff. That's pretty significant because we had 62 exits in our teachers. Why is that significant? Our teachers are probably twice the size of our overall support staff in total. So essentially, we're experiencing close to double the turnover rate in our support staff areas. We dug further into that information, and you saw in the graph that I provided in the summary information that our paras actually have experienced a turnover percentage of 26%. That's remarkable and overwhelming in a lot of ways. We knew anecdotally that that was likely going to be our highest area of turnover, but seeing the numbers really drove it home. Our food service, transportation follow that, our office staff at 16%, and then our custodians at 7%, or kind of how that all flows out. As a result of that, and kind of in keeping with our board goals and our overall strategic plan in the district, we have worked in the adult engagement area on the idea of onboarding and changing. Myself probably took off my mute on my computer. So we've been trying to work on the area of onboarding, not trying, we have been working on the area of onboarding. We've implemented a number of survey tools, including an exit interview that we're doing with all of our staff as they leave the district. Not everybody completes it, but we do provide it to everybody as they're leaving. We usually wait until just as they've left because we find that we get more accurate data when they're no longer connected to the school district. So that has been helpful. We have also been analyzing what concerns staff have brought forward from the engagement survey that we do each year. We have multiple years of data from that, and we can tease out all of the comments that came from a particular employee group. So we have pulled out comments from the paraeducators, overall ratings from the paraeducator group alone, and we have a committee of four paras, a secondary leadership person, an elementary leadership person, they're both secondary leadership folks. And then Diane Austin, Erin Wheeler from the Assistant Employee Services team, and myself. We began the process last Thursday, working on our onboarding process, breaking down what are the group issues that we're seeing and facing from the data overall, what do we do about that data and what we have not uncovered, and we will be continuing to work with that as well as gather additional data to ultimately get to a point by the end of the year where we have put together an onboarding process that will take our staff not just through their orientation, which they already get from the employee services team and others here in this building, but all the way through and into their first year. It may include a mentoring component, and really focusing in on some training and development issues actually were one of the number one areas that's been identified. So we have a lot of work still to do in that area. But I do want to say thank you to all of you for continuing to be interested in asking about that information, because it has caused us to dig deeper and to keep working on identifying those root causes and concerns in each of the employee areas. Once we do finish the onboarding process for the paraeducators, it won't be done, because we'll have a continuous feedback loop, getting feedback and data gathering from all of the employees in that group, especially our new hires, and we'll continue to tweak that. And all of that work will be a springboard for beginning that process with each of our employee groups. We've been doing an onboarding process that's been pretty robust for all of our teachers for a number of years now, over a decade easily, maybe two. We have not done as thorough of a job with our support staff, and I believe that the data is really showing that, and it's a key reason why we really need to focus some of our efforts in that area. So that's the big summary pieces that I wanted to share with you tonight, and I would just ask if you have any questions about the information that I included.
Yeah. Two questions. One is, do you have the opportunity to gather comparison statistics from other school districts to see whether our turnover is unique to here or is it sort of a trend? And the second question, you don't have to answer that one. The second question is, among the turnover, and I'm just going to throw out an example, like in food service, that 23% that leaves annually, what's percentage of that demographic that's relatively new hires like I said, is a big turnover among people who walk in, experience for a while, say this isn't for me, or is it across the spectrum?
Those are excellent questions.
Thank you.
The first question that you asked was about comparable data with other districts.
Yeah.
I do have that information. I'm aware of that information from multiple conversations that I have with the directors in the area, in the region. We are not unique. Our turnover, our teacher turnover data is around about what most of the other districts are experiencing. That 10% number is a pretty close hover for most. Support staff, although I don't have the specific percentages for the other school districts because I don't know very many districts who focus on that area as much, I do hear from them that they are experiencing turnover in the same areas that we are on a pretty rapid pace. Food service is a little unique because some districts are contracted service. So if you ask their HR directors, are you experiencing turnover, they really don't know because they don't employ them. Anecdotally, they would say, yes, they see some of that same turnover. They just don't have to deal with it in the same way. So that's the answer to your first question. The second question is the exact question that came about during Thursday's meeting with the committee, because we started looking at the numbers, and that exact question was asked by one of our paras. And we don't know for sure. I would, again, anecdotal from experience, would say we think that turnover is more of our newer hires, not necessarily brand new, but early in their career with us. However, we are going to be digging into that data to answer that question for the committee for their next meeting, which is scheduled for December before winter break. So I will have that exact information and would be happy to share that back with the board just as an informational email or something at some point down the road. You had a question, now
to
you.
No question.
Oh.
I was curious, you have identified reasons for leaving.
Mm-hmm.
I think, is that across the board or is that just teacher positions?
All of the tables are just the teacher positions.
Okay, then I'm curious, kind of off of the question that Bob asked, are the reasons they're leaving here consistent with what you're seeing in other districts too?
For the teachers?
For the support staff. Yeah.
So the reasons for the support staff leaving, we've begun gathering through the exit interview process. I don't know what the reasons have been for the other districts, but that is a good question. I certainly could check in. I would imagine they're going to be pretty similar, but I'll be sharing some of this information with the incoming director group, so they know the kinds of things that we're looking into. That may spark them to be looking into those same things.
Yeah.
That's kind of the trend we oftentimes see. So.
Great.
I just want to make sure I understand your answer to her. Did you say that you do or do not know the reasons, at least anecdotally, why the paras, what the reasons would be typically that the paras are leaving? Do we?
We have a number of reasons that they've provided. It's not usually just one. Salary is one of the reasons. We do not pay the highest in the area. And so it is one that's oftentimes shared. They sometimes are leaving education to get a higher salary in a private sector setting. The benefits are always incredibly high, and nobody's ever complained about our benefit package. So that has never been a reason, I can tell you that for certain. But some of the other things that we're hearing have to do with training and development and the onboarding things that you might imagine of, did anybody tell me where the bathroom is in this large building on my first day, as an example? Or do I have a safe place to put my purse or my belongings to leave them for the day? Feeling valued and feeling part of the staff are some of the, again, anecdotal reasons, but those are real reasons that people have given for choosing to move on.
Other classroom issues or issues related to their direct duties that people are bringing up?
Not that I recall offhand, but there's a lot of data in what they've provided overall as they've left, so those will be continued to be discussed with our committee as we move forward.
Okay, just
because those are all of the things, as we identify what the reasons are, we'll be teasing out what are the most, the highest impact areas that we can change, and we will be going after addressing those things.
That was kind of my next question.
Process. That's what the whole onboarding process with the committee is focused on.
And that was my second question, is to see if we take those reasons and plug them into the onboarding process, that the onboarding process is addressing those reasons specifically, or?
That's exactly our work. You got it. 100%.
And then just one other comment. I think Bob asked a very good question, but I, you know, whether it's the new people that are leaving at a higher rate, but I guess I would caution us in the sense that even if it proves to be true that it's the newer people leaving, that doesn't necessarily mean that there's not something we should be addressing, because if a lot of people are leaving, even though they're new, that may say something to us as a district that we need to address. Does that make sense?
I would argue that that's the biggest reason why we should be making a change.
Right.
Because if we're losing our newest people before they even get to know who we are, that's a bigger problem in my mind than people who've been here and they just need a change in terms of career. Because
right.
People do change career. I'm almost more concerned about people who've been with us for 2 years or less and they're moving on someplace else.
Are we sure of the same?
But the concerns are real on all fronts, and all of them really need to be addressed in the end. So for us to really have staff who want to be part of our organization, that's a really critical thing, and it's a part of our whole mission.
I was going to say, it's important for the board to know, because we've talked about this at Best Leadership, many or most, I'm not sure, of paraeducators, and for sure food service, and for sure transportation, don't meet the 30-hour-a-week threshold to qualify for insurance benefits. And so a lot of folks we have are saying, I need to look for a job that comes with benefits. So we've been trying to, for example, hire bus drivers and also hire them as paraeducators so they can drive in the morning, be a paraeducator during the day, drive in the evening, qualify for benefits. We tend to keep them longer. And so that's a challenge with the nature of food service and transportation in particular, but also paras, especially when they're working school hours, that doesn't add up to 30 hours a week.
Right, that's kind of baked in. That's
yeah, it's a baked in challenge.
Part of the, you know, by definition, yep. That's going to be, we're going to have a higher turnover rate, I would think, in those areas anyway. But
I think you alluded to this, so I apologize if I missed it. You know, one of the things that is on our board action items for our goals is to monitor loss of teachers. I'll just use teachers now, to other districts. So we have those numbers. They, you know, they don't, to me, they don't look terribly out of line. Like there's a more are leaving our district for other districts, but anecdotally, I mean, just because they left our district for another doesn't mean that, like, they got a better offer or were dissatisfied with us. Do you know why, or do you have, like, anecdotal evidence about why you'd leave for another district? Is it, again, anecdotally, is it, in your mind, increasing or becoming a bigger problem?
I don't know that it's increasing or becoming a bigger problem. Mobility of staff has increased overall with, as the years have gone by. So staff, it's rare now for staff who are newer and joining the profession to stay with a district for 20, 30 years and retire from there. Many of the staff members, anticipating that retirement is going to look really different for them, are staying for a few years and moving on. Sometimes they're moving location. Sometimes they are just looking for another opportunity. Maybe they are teaching elementary with us, but they really want to teach at the middle school and we don't have a middle school position that they've been able to get. So there's a lot of reasons, even in just moving districts, that are included in that section. Sometimes it's because they're dissatisfied. Could be for a lot of different reasons. It certainly happens, and I think that happens all around the board, but that turnover process, we talk about it every summer as we're trading staff amongst all of the districts. Like, yeah, Jason just hired another one down in Verona, and he's like, well, that's because you hired two for me last month. And, you know, so we have sort of a joking relationship about some of those things, but we're all open and recognizing that we're hiring from each other more than we ever used to, because staff are interested in mobility and thinking that they'll move forward with salary or other opportunities. Sometimes it's a better opportunity. Maybe they see a path towards leadership that they may not see here. That may or may not be true, because we don't always know what's going to happen with regard to those options. But some move because they have a desire to do something different or be someplace different.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like it's reached the point where that's a problem for our district yet, like something we're concerned about as a district.
I was going to say, if you go to, how many did we bring in from other districts?
Right, yeah. But, and I think the other thing is we see staff, I mean, I think we have really high quality staff here. And so we also see people who look at administrative positions or instructional coach positions and things where we have more people interested in those positions than we have positions. And so I think we also have seen a number of staff in recent years go to like a Madison where they have a lot more coaching positions because they're interested in moving into that kind of a role.
We've even seen some that have moved into another role in another district like that, and then the next year or the year after have come back to us when a similar role has opened up because they wanted to come back to the district. So not all who leave are necessarily disenfranchised with the district as a whole. Sometimes it's just the opportunity and the ability to prove themselves maybe in another role or another
opportunity. Yeah, I mean, that's really interesting. I think that's the thing that we're supposed to, as a board, keep track of as an action item on our goals. So that's really helpful information. And I mean, if the culture changes, you know, I think we'd want to know that too. I mean, if all of a sudden we face, you know, a change in how this is going down, I think I, as a board member, would like to know that.
And if I could, I just want to comment, as I noticed from looking at the numbers, the last 2 years, we had 20 and 22 teachers who either went to another district or another district new position. So that's about a third where, yeah. And so it's not really a concern, but it just indicates the mobility issue that we are seeing more and more people moving around. And so I guess as we start moving forward and looking at this, should the board be asking other questions in terms of mobility, you know, as we look at this and we understand that mobility is now just a fact of life. We no longer have a golden parachute like we used to have, where once somebody started working someplace, they wanted to finish out their time because they got the payout at the end. That doesn't seem to be as important anymore, the more looking at the positions. So as we move forward, I just want to make sure that we stay competitive in terms of salary. Benefits obviously are important, but they're somewhat the same going across the board. And then whatever intangibles that are out there, that we recognize mobility is a fact of life, what do we need to be doing to make sure that we're keeping the best of the best?
No, go ahead. You had your hand up longer.
Actually, I just had a couple of requests. Mm-hmm. I think it would be nice to get this same pie chart for the support staff.
Yeah,
when we have the information. Mm-hmm. But then the other request would be that the colors stay the same from year to year.
Yeah.
So. Oh, okay. I can let Erin know that. She produced all the graphs when we got all the information, and I guess I didn't think about that. So that's a good point, because you would want to compare orange to orange to orange, right? Okay.
Thank you.
We'll make that request next year for sure. Thank you.
The question I have is 26% turnover, what is the cost of educating, integrating what is the cost of the process of finding 26% new people to come in? What's the cost of bringing them up to speed at, you know, the whole thing across the spectrum? Is there a target point where you say we can save money if we do X, we can get it down to 10%? You know, is there a savings there that we can somehow figure out?
We don't have a hard and fast dollar amount that's attached to that, but what I would tell you is the cost is significant. There's a number of studies out there that'll tell you how much turnover cost is for a professional staff member and compared to a support staff member. Every time we have turnover, there's some loss that happens in terms of knowledge base. There's some loss that happens in terms of experience and overall just the service level that we provide to students, particularly when you're dealing with the paraeducators. Our paraeducators work so close and so direct with our students that there is some upheaval when that turnover happens. Part of our committee work will be trying to put an actual dollar amount to what that is and to figure out what we can do in terms of investment to offset that, because they're costs that are not as obvious. It's not like we lose $10,000 in our budget directly, when a turnover situation happens, but the reality is obviously we have some costs that are connected there. And then there's the subtle costs in terms of impact to students' learning and or connection and things with staff. So those are all things that we'll be diving in a lot deeper for.
First of all, I'll just say thank you. I think in terms of reports, this one is actually, as Todd had mentioned, one that actually goes more direct towards the board in terms of what we're looking for. So I know I look forward to it every year. And the fact you guys took some time to dive into our other employees, I think was very important as well. I think there'll be some benefits as well, some possible actions being brought back to the board for some possible changes as well. I'd be very curious to hear just what, you know, Bob had talked about, the dollar relationship between turnover. That's a guess. You know, it's not like if I spend $2 an hour more, I'm going to decrease turnover by 7% or 10%, and then turn around and present a formula back to the board. But we are living in a point right now in Dane County where I think it's under 3%, where you're at the chronically unemployed at that particular point, where it's difficult to find people because of the unemployment being so low. But we are in a unique situation. We obviously are in an industry that requires people to work with our students. So I would look forward to hearing any solutions that administration would have brought forward to the board.
Yep. There's actually one more that, if you don't mind sharing, that Tabitha's going to start on a small scale this year. It's a concept called state interviews. It's research-based. Organizations from all over the country, all different kinds of organizations. And it's exactly what it is you actually interview people, not to hire them, but to keep them, and they're random, and you can gather feedback and find out what it is that keeps people here, what it is that might have them start to look before they actually look, and then we can use that information to address, you know, individual people concerns, but also address our organizational reaction to that. So it's all part of our adult engagement district goal.
Just so they know, they're not interviewing to keep their job.
Yes.
It will be very clear.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, to state the obvious. Yeah.
No, it's great.
We value you. We want you to stay forever.
Okay.
That's why we're having this discussion.
And we want to learn from what they like about being here to make sure that we're applying some of those things in all of our buildings. Maybe it's something that's happening in one or two buildings, but we want to make sure that those things are also implemented district-wide, because if some buildings are benefiting from them, shouldn't others as well? It's a really great concept. So we're looking forward to some of those opportunities because they're right around the corner for us. So.
Thank you, Tanya.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Hey, review possible 2019-2020 and 2020-21 school calendars. Sherry, you want them ready?
Yep. Team it.
Excellent. Sherry, you're just going to jump right over there to join them, right?
I can. I'm good.
By the way, how are you doing, Sherry? How are you?
I'm much better. Good. I'm almost walking normally.
Congratulations.
With a cane.
Go ahead.
I think you got the proposed calendars and description, Cheryl. So really, we're just here to answer questions.
Maybe George, if you give some more
information. Yeah, I did, because this came up at agenda setting. Really, the basic proposals come to you with a fifth professional development day rather than four that we've had the last 2 years. With the work of MTSS and the really planned, purposeful PD around data summits and looking at student achievements and interventions and metrics, the team laid out location of those PD days strategically, but also number. And then Sherry is our DPI minutes guru, and even with the fifth PD day, how many hours are we ahead?
We're 5 days of leeway then. At the
5 days of snow days built in across, that's the minimum. I mean, that's the lowest number and more across the entire district. So the two choices here will be surveyed to parents and staff on the longer winter break spilling into that second week of June, or the shorter winter break being able to end first week of June. Those are the kind of the decision points. But we wanted to make sure you were comfortable as a board moving to that fifth professional development day for very purposeful reasons, so that we can go ahead and send the survey out tomorrow.
Maybe on that note, you've heard in the roundtable sessions and the engagement sessions with staff that they are really looking for more time as collaborative team members and more time to get together, so that we want to work with the principal teams, the building level administrative teams, to make sure that we run as a system, but also to make sure that we're running horizontal and vertical conversations for
everything. Well, just so the board understands, this will be an action item at a later date.
Yep, next board meeting, yes.
And we'll have information.
Yeah, Perry will present the survey results at that time.
We'll be able to make a decision based on results from staff and parents.
Have we, or did we consider going to even a sixth PD day? Going for the gusto a little bit, you know, given the scope of what we're trying to do. I mean, was that even in the realm of discussion?
The pushback on that is then you have to have parents that got to cover another day. It's traditionally a school day.
I'm not advocating necessarily. I'm just wondering if it was considered or thought about or talked about.
I won't say that it wasn't considered, but I mean, considering what Bob just shared and just some factors that we tried to weigh in, weigh out, that kind of thing, we wanted to not be overly aggressive with days, but also knowing that we do know our staff really need time and we want to give them time.
Right.
We did have some more radical proposals that we didn't bring forward to you.
Yeah.
Like 45-15 four times throughout the year. So 45 days on, 15 off. Collaboration built in at the beginning and end of each of those. So we didn't bring that forward yet.
Not yet.
Not yet.
The only other major difference in the two of these I noticed was this timing on spring break. One is in March and one spills into April.
I'll let you talk about that because I think
I think one spills into April on both of them in the second year of the calendar, and then one of them is about the same time in both calendars, 1920 and 2021. And the second year of the calendar on both of them, I think Good Friday happens to be on April 2nd. And so it just naturally sort of gets built into that spring break week. The other one is a little bit later because of how late end of semester is. It's not super late, but we're trying to also make sure that the breaks are at kind of a reasonable timeline. So that's kind of why it's the end of quarter three and then spring break, which makes it easier on kids when they're not like lingering over to have some like few days of third quarter left over after their spring break. So I think those of you who have been high school parents as of late know that they're doing a lot of, well, they're probably trying to minimize that, the reason for it.
Okay, I'm looking forward to hearing next steps on this, and thank you for taking the time.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Action items. Cheryl. Amendment to record retention schedule.
Just wanted to go over a couple of these things. As you well know, the state of Wisconsin gives us open records law and what we have to keep. The last time the state did anything was 2010. We did an amendment in 2016. the three things that are on here are not things that are specific on the records retention. And the two technology ones were ones that Jim brought to my attention, and we talked about those. The phone records is actually the call detail that happens in the background on our phones. Voicemail is kept longer, but this is the call details. And the 100 days is a restriction on the system that we have. That's all that our system allows us for our phone system. The video recordings, obviously those are the ones that happen in all our buildings all the time. And we have 30 days that we can promise depending on what's going on. The up to 2 years is anything that would be part of an investigation, anything that would be part of student discipline. Let's say somebody broke into our building, all those things are then saved for up to 2 years, and it says at the designation of the superintendent. Obviously we do that. We do that right now with recordings on the bus. If there's a discipline issue, we have to hang on to those. So that's them, those two. And then we have our visitor logs in the buildings. And believe it or not, nobody is consistent with this. I've even asked other districts on what they do, and they're like, oh, were we supposed to keep those? So we determined 30 days for each building to maintain their visitor logs. Otherwise, we could have boxes and boxes and boxes of visitor logs. And this way, it will be consistent across the district. It is not now. And all of this, I did talk with Bob Butler, and you know, he was fine with them. He didn't think anything was out of whack on what we were proposing. So in order for this to go through, in order for us to change our records retention schedule, because the board approves the records retention, you would have to approve this amendment, and then I send this amendment on to the state, and then they would also have to approve it before it ends up in our records retention schedule. So this is kind of the first step.
I did send out an email, and you answered several of my questions already, and it does make sense with the electronic recordings. You know, from what you're saying, I have to go by what you're saying, what Jim says, that this is a pain to, or technologically difficult to,
and costly.
Costly to retain the phone records or the video recordings for longer. And I do like the provision in there that the superintendent can presumably automatically designate, you know, 2 years for anything that comes up. That's of concern. But I guess the visitor log thing bothers me a little bit, in the sense that, you know, to go from 7 years down to 30 days is pretty kind of a whiplash change in my view. And I think, you know, Lord forbid, if there's ever an intruder or some incident or an attack in one of our schools, having a visitor log could be extremely helpful for law enforcement and for an investigation going back to investigate whatever incident might occur of that nature. So I think, you know, it strikes me, I don't know how many pages of visitor logs we go through in a day, I can't imagine that's going to be more than a few extra three-ring binders basically holding some of this stuff.
And right now, I'm telling you, they're not being kept.
I'm sorry?
They're not being kept right now on a regular basis, and this is something.
If I can piggyback on that, I agree completely with Kurt, but as far as maintaining information, scan them, put them in PDF files and create a file, because for the exact reasons he articulates, 30 days isn't very long, but you know, you don't have to physically keep the paper in cardboard boxes. It's easy to scan it, and you can compress that file down each month for each school, compress it, and then it's there, and then you can set a 5-year limit on that, because I think that's an important record to keep.
Yeah, I would propose as a minimum, you know, 90 days for these logs, and if we can scan them, then I think we should consider a lot longer than that. And part of not wanting to retain records is about reducing district liability, and I get that. You know, we want to reduce cost, and we want to reduce the potential liability. On the other hand, as a public entity, we want to be transparent, And we want to, especially when it comes to safety of children and so forth, we want to have records that are fully of use potentially to law enforcement or district investigations. So I would really, you know, I think Bob agrees with me, I'd like to see something significantly longer on the visitor log. So I don't know what the rest of the board feels about that, but.
In some form. They don't have to be paper, but.
Have we asked law enforcement? I mean, like, how do they feel about it? I know you said in your email back to Kurt that it's not, they've not raised an issue, but have we said, what kind of evidence would you like if there's been an incident? Do you need the visitors' logs? Would that be helpful to you? I mean, if they say they serve no purpose whatsoever, then that'd be one thing, but if they're important.
I don't know that they would say they serve no purpose. I mean, everything is always valuable. I know we constantly are having conversations, obviously, with law enforcement because they're in our buildings every day and through our safety committees. And I can tell you, I've been here, this is my 14th school year. We've had one request in 14 years, and it was from a parent, and we had to redact all the information anyway, and they didn't get it. I don't know how often our law enforcement goes to those records. I don't hear much about that. A lot of times it's video is our biggest friend in that, you know, in that case. But we've never had law enforcement coming to us asking for those logs.
Well, I guess my comment to that is you don't know that you need it until you need it.
Right.
And I was a law enforcement officer for 10 years, and I think that potentially this could be something that's important. If there is an attack in a school, then that's one thing they are going to want to look at is did this person show up before? Did any accomplices
right.
of this person or friends or associates of this person show up before to case the school or to, you know, visit before? So I think that, you know, law enforcement may say, well, we don't know, but they won't. You know, if something happens, they're going to want that. They're going to look at that. And it seems like a cheap way to provide potential evidence in a critical, you know, if we only need it once in 20 years, that's not very often, but we're really going to want it on that one time.
Yeah, my point of my question is to see if we had any extra information, but I completely agree with you. Just as it strikes me, 30 days seems very short to me, particularly, it seems short to me, you know, advising clients how long to keep things. 30 days is suggestive of a record that you actually want to get rid of. You know, like we only have to keep this 30 days. It strikes me as like something that we're suggesting we want to actually get rid of. So I think everything else is fine. I would suggest that we have a different number for the logs.
Should we have a recommended length on that?
12 months.
2 years. Well, I guess we should probably first find out how much trouble or expense it is to scan documents, but if we have an answer for an estimate of that already, then we could probably.
If you scan it, it doesn't matter whether you keep it 1 year, 2 years, or 3 years.
Right. 30 days on paper, and perhaps. I'm just trying to sound out that, you know, I have any wise thought, but 30 days on paper and scan for 2 years.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're actually looking at some systems, electronic systems out there mm-hmm. that I believe would keep the record electronically.
Oh, like that, electronic sign-in.
Yep, yeah. And so.
Then there wouldn't be a second step.
Right. And so maybe this is a short term until we get to that point. Let's come up with a number tonight. And then that may take care of it anyway, because there's a badging system and that gets scanned. And I'm guessing it all gets, you know, cataloged in a computer system. So
let's say 12 months. And
12 months
I
to
think
get
eventually
us mid-year next year, pretty
yeah.
much.
Do we want 12 months paper or do we want.
Yeah, if we just say 12 months, we can do scanning.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because it's not fail-safe. I mean, you have events like we have the Thanksgiving lunches coming up. They don't do sign-ins for any of those. Like, there's still events where
well,
we have
know, it's
a
not
lot
a catch
of visitors
all be all.
That it's
just
not.
One more bit of information.
Or any parent that just comes in and drops something off in the office, they don't sign into the building. So, I mean, it's nice, but it's not a complete record of anyone who's.
Well, and I understand that.
Go to this system.
Yeah, it's more the video that's the most important.
Yeah.
Okay, so do you need a motion?
Yeah, I guess I'll.
It's an action item, yes.
Make a motion that we amend this amendment.
Yeah.
And simply add or create a retention period of 1 year for the visitor logs for the buildings. In a manner to be determined by the district or by the custodians.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Thank you.
I just had a question, because you said the custodians, but they're not going to be the ones that are doing it.
No, the custodian of the record.
Okay.
Good to clarify, though.
Other duties as assigned, apparently.
Good to clarify, nothing wrong with that.
Okay. Always a fun one, approval of Godfrey and Kahn payment.
Not participating.
Looking for a motion to approve?
So moved.
I'll second.
Any questions, concerns? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Resolution authorizing a taxable tax and revenue anticipation promissory note for cash flow purposes in an amount not to exceed $4,455,000.
So moved.
Second.
Questions, concerns? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. All right, I think we took care of your.
Yes, it did.
We are now out of items, moving into closed.
Thank you, Lori.
Yes. So at this particular time, we are looking to convene for a closed session under State Statute 19.85, subsection 1, sub F, decision on expulsion order. I think this is a roll call.
Yes.
Aye.
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 Need a motion in a second.
Oh. I move that we go into closed session.
And moved.
So we voted before we had a motion.
Wait a second.
Second, I'll second it.
I'll second.
Do a roll call again.
Aye.
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 Apologies.
Can we take just a couple minutes to get signature?